ज्ञापन बाबा सिरेंद्र आई गिव यू ऑल दी सेम मुरली एंड दी सेम मेथड ऑफ प्रैक्टिसिंग मेडिटेशन दी सेम नॉलेज इज गिवन टू यू ऑल. इट इज नॉट दैट बाबा गिव्स सेपरेट ट्यूशन टू एनीवन बट स्टिल देयर इज डिफरेंस इन दी स्पिरिचुअल स्टेज and in the spiritual attainment of each one of us. What makes this difference? Vaguely we say that it is because of our efforts. Since each one of us has difference in karmic accounts, in sanskaras, and also in the quantum of efforts which we make, therefore, that ultimately leads to the difference in our spiritual stage. That is generally the explanation which we have in our mind. But to be more clear about this, I did some journey and I will share with you. And I find that in order to make good efforts so as to have higher attainments, to make rapid and quick progress, we have to build up 18 abilities. Basic abilities. It is these abilities which are mainly involved in our efforts. These constitute our efforts. So when we say that there is a difference between the efforts of each one of us, actually it means that there is difference in regard to these 18 basic abilities or 18 basic powers which we have to build up in order to attain spiritual, full spiritual inheritance from Shri Baba. I have not arranged them in proper order, but you can arrange according to your own. Therefore, I just begin. And the first one I will mention is the power or the ability to listen. Because the very first thing is when we have our 1 week course, or when we listen to the Murli, we listen. The ability of listening differs from person to person. So that gives the start to the differences. How we listen, the way we listen, our approach to listening. Sometimes it so happens that a person is physically present, the ears are open, one is listening, but the mind is somewhere else. Or when the person is listening, in between the mind wanders away. There is no focus, no concentration in listening, no full attention. So when we are listening, whether mentally we are alert, whether we are properly understanding the meanings of what we are listening. Secondly, sometimes it so happens that all of us have our own conditioning. We have been reading some books, some periodicals. We have had our exposure to media. So many human beings have been giving their opinions to us. All that has been stored up in our mind. So when we listen, we interpret what somebody is saying in terms of what is there already. So that gives a color to what we listen. Whether we can detach ourselves for some time from what we already have to what is being told at this moment, this kind of detachment. We practice detachment from the body, but this kind of detachment of the useless knowledge which is told in our mind, the rubbish which we have collected over a period of time, life after life. So much negative things which are lurking somewhere in our mind. They come up at the moment and we try to build our own interpretations of what somebody is listening. So when we are listening to someone, let us understand what he or she wants to say. What are the meanings which he or she wants to convey? Let us be detached. Because if we think that whatever we have listened is correct, and what this person is telling, he or she is not a knowledgeable person, and has no credentials to tell it to us, we doubt the very integrity of the person, or the capability, the ability of the person, then actually we are not listening. We are condemning outright. From the very beginning, our ears may be open, our mind is closed. The mind is not listening. There is a rejection from the mind of whatever is being said. That is not the proper way of listening. Later on you may reject after considering it on its merits. But first of all, you give a patient listening and an impartial listening, unbiased listening. A listening which is not touched by your conditioning, but what you already know. That may give you the ability of understanding, but don't try to give negative or positive value to what you are listening according to what your present beliefs are. Your present beliefs may be very different from what is being told to you now. The latest information, the new knowledge may not be matching with what is there already in your mind. And therefore, you may say, yes, I know, it's not correct, I don't agree. Immediately you pass judgments. Unless and until you have listened to what the person wants to say in full. Sometimes we have listened to one statement, the person has not even completed what one wants to say. And we jump to conclusions. And we intervene. And then we say, we pass our judgments. Even the judge in a court listens to both the prosecution and to the defense and allows them proper time for argumentation, for producing evidence. And having weighed the merits and demerits of both parties, what they want to say, having given them proper opportunity, proper hearing, now he wants to be detached, an impartial person, a neutral person, as he cannot judge. If he is already biased, he cannot be judged. And you know, in law, if a person feels that he has partiality to a particular case, maybe one of the parties to the suit is his relative, and he has love, he has attachment with that person. So he can say that I won't sit in this judgment to this party, to this suit, because a party is already having some relationship with me. Let another judge occupy this chair. So he himself offers to not be judged in that case. The reason being that you have to do justice when you are impartial, unbiased, unprejudiced. If there are justice, I mean, like what happened in America recently, in the case of a black man being tried and being given a beating by the policeman. You know what happened later on, the aftermath of all of it. The judge passed some judgment, being partial on the basis of race. So if any kind of partiality, bias, conditioning, previous beliefs, they color our listening, it is not listening. Therefore, Baba says, you have to know me, what I am, how I am. Main jo hoon, jaisa hoon. You know Baba. But you know Baba according to your own understanding. According to what you have been listening and coloring it from what you already knew. You have to listen to Baba what he wants to say. A new knowledge should be listened to just with a very, very open mind, with a very impartial mind. Very often when you give course to somebody, someone has studied geology, and when you for the first time give him knowledge about the world wheel and the world tree, the kalpa tree, and you say that the cycle is 5,000 years. If that geologist or anthropologist or anyone who has studied history or geography or some
similar branch of knowledge and has been in touch with the latest scientific findings as they are reported in various periodicals of science and other subjects, other disciplines. He jumps to that conclusion, but how can this be 5,000 years, he says. How can this be? Shouts. Now, instead of feeling wonderstruck, surprised, and having the curiosity to know something new, this could also be the attitude. Really, is it 5,000 years? How? Now, the question can be asked. The curiosity, knowledge, is a response to curiosity. If we have no curiosity, we cannot take knowledge. So curiosity has to be there, but not the bias. Just to believe that whatever I have already learnt is true and final, then that means I cannot learn anymore. My learning has stopped. I have become an aged person so far as learning is concerned. I can take no more. So if I want to take knowledge, if I want to understand some new thing, the curiosity has to be there. A sense of amazement, wonder, because when you have this kind of an approach that you feel wonderstruck, even in some of the Murlis, Baba says, you know what Shiv Baba eats, what Shiv Baba takes, what is the attitude of Shiv Baba? In Hindi it is said, Shiv Baba kya khata hai? And the answer is, wonder khata hai. Shiv Baba is wonderstruck. Bachchon par Baba ko wonder aati hai. Baba feels a sense of wonder when he sees a particular kind of reaction on the part of the children. So that sense of wonder, amazement, curiosity is what gives you more hunger, digestibility of knowledge. You can take more. Okay. That is an appetizer, so to say. That is not forbidden. But just to build up mental barriers to what is being said already is creating hindrances for your own learning. So when I say we have to build up the power of learning, what I mean the power of listening or the ability of listening, what I mean is whatever you have learned, keep that apart, aloof, aside for some time. And try to understand the background, the understanding of that person. Therefore, we generally ask the biodata of a person. When a person is speaking, what is the biodata? What discipline this person has studied? What is his age? How much maturity he has? What are his hobbies? What is his family background? So on and so forth. That gives us just an insight into what this person is saying. Now, why? Because when we want to meet a person, when there is going to be our first exposure to a person, we have not only to see the face, we are not face readers, but we just want to understand the bio data and to understand with what background that person is saying. As we cannot make out of what this person is saying. Similarly, when we are listening, let us try to understand from the point of view of that person. Somebody says the soul merges into God. Now we say the soul does not merge into God. Once upon a time we used to believe that the soul merges into God as the rivers merge into ocean. Or as the fire, the wind and other elements of matter merge into their respective elements, the other elements. So does the soul ultimately merge into God. As gold can be mixed into gold, so can soul be mixed into Brahm or Supreme Soul. Now we don't believe it. If we had not listened to what is being said in this university, in the way which later on we adopted, we would have not been here today. So it was our ability of listening properly, giving a chance to somebody to speak what one wants to say, and try to understand the arguments, the background of that person, why that person wants to say a particular thing, keeping your thing aside. Then you understand it. And give proper time, don't jump to conclusions in a hasty way. That is another requisite of proper listening. Don't be hasty. Don't make judgments. Don't jump to conclusions without giving a proper hearing to somebody. So there should be no conditioning, no bias, no prejudices of any kind. Get detached from your old beliefs, old knowledge, old information. Listen patiently. Don't feel disturbed Don't try to intervene. And then try to understand it from the point of view of the person who says that thing. Then later on make your own judgments. You are the master of your own choice. You may agree, you may not agree. You are a free person. You have the right to believe. But before you exercise your right, I have the right to express. Just as you have the right to believe, I have the right to express. Give me the proper opportunity to express. So this is what proper listening is. And then also there should be concentration. No wandering of the mind, here, there and anywhere. So that if we mix a comma or a full stop, or there was a court case, someone said that I have sold this ground and this piece of land. That piece of land had 2 tennis courts. Now, a part of the land was on this side of the tennis court, 1 tennis court, and the other part of the land on the other side of the tennis court. Now, a typing mistake occurred, and in that it was mentioned, not tennis courts, but tennis court. This single S was missing. Now the person who had sold, he entered into litigation with the party which had purchased, and he later on said that he had sold that piece of land which was on this side of tennis court, not courts. So the other half was still his. That was his claim. And the other party said, the purchasing party, no, you had sold the whole land and I have purchased the whole land. And it is not tennis court, it is tennis courts. It is only a typing error. Now, why you say it is a typing error? The person says, I have mentioned the boundaries. On the left, on the north, on the south, on the east, on the west. The location of the building mentions. So if you just see, on the left is this building, on the right is that building, and so on. It has been mentioned. And so much is the area. So that should be courts. The judge finally decreed that this person who says that it is a typing error, he is correct. And the other party is wrong, and he should pay the damages for the suit. Now, not only that person did not get the other part of the land, but had instead to pay the damages of the suit. Now, why the judge made judgment like that? Because he considered the whole thing in toto, totally. If one does not give the meaning to the whole picture, you just show a part of the picture, cover the rest of it. A person cannot make out. All these things have to be joined together. If you just ask an artist to make my ears on one piece of paper, nose on another piece of paper, head on another piece of paper, perhaps you may not be able to make it is Jagdish Bhai. You see. You have to join these to make some sense. Perhaps you may be so wise, perhaps, to make out of it, but unless or until you join the statements of a person in complete, in fullness, in total, you do not understand properly what that person wants to say. So that listening has to be without missing the comma, the full stop, the grammar. The grammar not of the language mainly, but the grammar of the reasoning, the grammar of the expression of that person. You have to understand. Because when that person is saying something, he is saying sometimes like this, sometimes making certain gestures, smiling, laughing, showing some kind of a repugnance on his face, displeasure reflected into his eyes. All those also must be understood. They carry some meaning. They put emphasis on what that person is saying. Like when you print something, you underline certain things, you put certain things in bold type. You give headings to something. You number them. You place them in proper sequence, in proper order. And the whole thing means there are some clauses, there are some sub-clauses. Subclasses are subclasses, classes are classes. They have their own place in the whole structure. Similarly, when you listen to something, listen it in this way, in fullness. What does Baba want to say? If you just listen to Baba's Murli last night, the way when he was smiling, laughing, making gestures, saying something, then there was a pause, then he would take some speed, then he would speak slowly. Then he would look into your eyes, be silent for some time, then again begin to speak. All this has some meaning. Those are the silent ways of expression. It is not that when he speaks, then only he says something. And when he is looking into the eyes and is just in a silent way giving you some vibrations, then at that time he is silent, not expressing. Those are there, but they are not put in the murli. That what Baba spoke is printed. After that there was a pause and Baba was looking, and so was the expression on his face. This is not mentioned in the murli. Therefore is the benefit of listening to Baba's murli face to face. It means different. You know the context. You have been here. What were the ceremonies? What were the festivities he was mentioning? All those things add to that meaning, to that strength, to that emphasis. So then you learn it better. You get better image and better impression than the other peoples whom you would give details when you go back and say it happened like that, it happened like that, you know. But your own personal presence and the way you were attentive. Some of the people might be, because it became late, maybe not that much alert mentally, may have missed some of the nuances of what Baba wanted to say, the emphasis which he wanted to put. So listening properly, unless and until we listen to murli, I very much doubt whether we listen 100% of murli. I think we listen perhaps to 5 or 10% of murli at the most. If I apply this standard of proper listening, we are seeing some people are going, some people are coming, some are moving, some are doing something, some another. We may have some urgent piece of work to do, we may be thinking of something back home, so on and so forth. So we are not properly listening. When we are in class listening to murli, if we are absent from elsewhere, wherever it be, and are there in the class with Baba, sitting face to face and listening to what he is saying, no other thought can enter our mind. All the other doors are closed. Only me and my teacher is there. That one is speaking and I am totally listening. And my total attention is on every spelling, every letter of that what he is saying. That is proper listening. And when I get up from that class, I will be so full, brimming with that happiness, with that joy, enlightened, feeling that I have had so much today, and it's enough, much more. And then I begin to absorb. Because when you take food, then the process of absorbing it, your body accepting it and making it a part of it, it takes time. But first of all, you gulp your food, you put it down your throat, into your stomach it goes, and the process starts. So that is the first thing, listening. That makes a lot of difference. When Baba says, and now anyone who is sitting there on the last bench now is also listening, because presently our acoustics, our sound system is such, anyone can listen from anywhere, but may not be able to see certain things. Why are perhaps the ears would have been enough? The eyes were perhaps not needed? No. But when we listen and we see the person speaking, what is the difference between the audio-visual and the merely audio? The audio-visual has more impact, lasting impact. Similarly, when we see Baba and we listen, therefore there are closed-circuit TVs, so that if you can't see it from there, you see it from there. Here as well as listen, they both aid each other. And then we have the proper listening. So when I am talking of listening, I do not mean only listening through the ears, but also through the eyes. So, through eyes and through ears, with that feeling. Because unless and until you feel what that person is saying, that means you are not listening. You are only recording, that's all. Like a cassette player, like a tape recorder can tape what you are saying. That is not listening. Can you say that this cassette is listening? This cassette is recording. Similarly, you may also be recording. If you have got great memory, if I ask you to recapitulate and to speak out what was said, you may be a genius in that area, and you may speak, you may literally repeat whatever was said. So you are a good, better than tape recorder, perhaps. But listening means understanding the meaning of it. and feeling. Because if the person is giving you something through words, words are just symbols, they are the carriers of some message. And through that he wants to convey some feeling. Whether you are having that kind of feeling which he is giving you. If not, then that means there is some reservation still in your mind. Some kind of resistance. You are not properly listening. So this ability of listening in that way has to be developed. The second is power of understanding. Therefore, Baba generally asks, when he is giving that avyakt murli, "Achha bache samjhe, children, do you understand?" Very often he asked. Yesterday he did not ask. That was perhaps the first time he did not ask. As much as I can remember, whenever I am before Baba, he would say, "Achha bache samjhe, samjha, do you understand?" We say, "Yes, we understand. Haanji." Baba repeated last night also in a different way. "Haanji," he asked. "Haanji" also means the same thing. You understand? Yeah. So, to understand, what is understanding? Because if someone shoots with a 303 gun and the bullet hits me here, if I don't die, then it must be a toy gun. It must not be a real gun. If it really hits me at my heart or into my brain, then I should be dead. If I am not dead, it is perhaps not the right type of gun which he has used. Or his purpose was different, to make me afraid, to scare me rather than to kill me. If someone wants to kill me and uses a powerful, proper weapon, then I should get killed. Like Baba was saying that our vibration should be so strong that it should break all the resistance in between and reach the place where it must hit its target. Otherwise that vibration is weak. It is surrounded by the clouds, or there are some walls as barriers in between. Otherwise perhaps the vibration is weak, else why does it not go? Same must be said of the understanding. If we are not changing, if we are not improving, if our progress has stopped, we are not understanding. Let us check up. There is something wrong with our understanding. We got stuck up at somewhere. There is a blockage. Like there may be a blockage in brain or in heart, and that part of the body may get diseased. There may not be blood circulation in some part of the body, and that may be paralyzed. So is our understanding perhaps sometime paralyzed, or there is some kind of a blockage, no proper circulation in it. So we have therefore to see whether we really understand, and therefore Baba asked, "Haanji, will you do it?" So when we say, "Yes, we will do it," what he actually wants to clarify is, have we understood it? What does understanding mean? Have you understand its significance, understood its significance, its depth, its value, its power, its impact, its merits, its utility? As what you have understood, the dictionary meaning of what Baba is saying is intelligible. You all, of course, understand. We all understand. But then what is the difference between understanding of a person A and another person B? Why is the difference between the efforts and the stage of attainment of two persons? Because they all do not understand it in the same depth. They do not have the same broader vision. They do not get the same power from that understanding. It is because they don't understand its importance, its significance, its utility, its merits. And if they don't properly do its consequences, what will happen? Its seriousness, or whatever you may say, of doing it and of not doing it, of accepting it and not accepting it. They don't understand the difference. They just, there are some people who are sentimental, emotional. So, in emotion, in sentiment, it's nice to say that yes, we will do it. But before we say, how much is our ability, how much is our time, how much is our energy, how we are going to do it, what we are going to do it, what is the standard of measurement of what we are going to do it, what are the criteria? Now, without understanding it, if I say yes, I will do it, you see. Of course, our mind works so quickly, faster than even a computer. The factors are already there in our mind, they are programmed. And many of us, or some of us, can say instantly, then and there, yes, we will do it. Else, it requires time. But in any case, we have to understand first of all, how important it is. For example, when he was saying, Baba was saying last night, you all use the word I. All through the day, at least 25 times, 20 times, 30 times, each one of us uses this word I. But who are you? Baba said. Is it the soul which has entered the body or body entered into the soul? I think he says certain such like things in order to waken us if we are asleep. Because if we are asleep and if he says, is it the body which has entered the soul? Is it the soul which has entered the body? Because we are asleep. To us it does not make difference. Now if we are not physically, our brain center is not sleeping, but sometimes we may be sleeping in terms of our understanding. Our understanding is not awakened. See. So we may be saying, yes, yes, haanji, haanji. See. But when you say haanji, yes, is your understanding awake? Are you really listening? Are you properly understanding its implications? That is what Baba wants to say. So when I understand my real identity, the meaning of I, and what difference it makes if I just understand its meaning properly. I, if you read any dictionary, Webster dictionary, Oxford dictionary, Cambridge dictionary, Standard dictionary, so many dictionaries. I, they will say self, but what is self? Now, I or self, nowhere is it mentioned, it refers to the soul which entered the body, as Baba was explaining last night. So I had wrong learning. Now, through proper method of listening, I understand that I refers to soul, that point of light, not to this body. So Baba said that when you just use this word I, previously you used it in relation to your body, thinking that you are a physical person. You are this assemblage of your organs. This body referred to, it was synonymous. I and the body was almost synonymous for you. But now when you use this word I, that point of light should emerge on the screen of your mind. I. That point of light I am. That infinitesimal point of light. This will make a lot of difference. It will give me Swaraj, Raj and Bhag. Each one of us wants to become king, Baba said. Raja. This is Raj Yoga, not Praja Yoga. You all want to become king. If I can become king for 21 lives, 20 lives, just by understanding, by remembering that I refers to soul, a point of light, do I understand how much difference it makes? This single point, whether the earth moves around the sun or sun moves around the earth, this made a lot of difference. So it is said that Copernicus, he gave a turning point to understanding of man. Previously, it was geocentric. I mean, they considered that it moves around the earth, the sun moves around the earth. It brings a revolution in your understanding. If we understand properly, if we properly understand its implications. So tremendous is the attainment, enormous is the attainment out of this understanding, I am a point of light, this single thing. Baba said this single lesson which is given to you on the very first day when you enter the portals of this university, that you are a soul, not this body. Have we really still understood it? Understood it deeply, properly, with all its implications of not understanding its consequences. How much we lose, how much we gain, if we don't practice it and if we practice it. This is proper understanding. So, the second is to build up the ability of understanding whatever Baba says. In Murli, there are so many statements. Do I understand the every comma and full stop of it? Every statement of it? Every sentence of it? Its implications, its meanings, its depth? That is proper understanding. That is the second ability. The third is the power or the ability to visualize. Visualize. Some people may have these eyes normal, without aiding this sight by glasses, they may be able to see, may have good vision. But whether our mind can make pictures, can visualize, for example, when destruction will take place, what will happen? How will golden age be like? How is Paramdham? Where is Paramdham? And how will life be in golden age? What will our relationships be like in golden age? Unless and until we have the proper ability to visualize all these things, even if we understand and we have listened properly, we cannot make much progress. Because in the practice of meditation, I have to take my mind to Paramdham and to visualize there Shiv Baba. A point of light, a brilliant point of light, radiating light. Now, can I visualize a place in space beyond sun and stars where there is golden red light, which is different from the light which we have in this world, which is not the material light but the divine light? In that light, there is silence. There is peace everywhere. And in that world, there is the Supreme Soul who is shining, emitting light. Can I see Him in His original glory? Can my mind properly visualize it and stay there for some time? Is it a really clear picture of it? A pinpointed picture? Very detailed picture? Like when we take photographs, some may be blurred, very hazy, not clear, others may be clear. So what kind of pictures or visualizations can our mind make? Go to the golden age, just visualize. And because if you do not properly visualize, then you cannot understand the difference between the Iron Age and golden age. It does not motivate you to work for golden age. If golden age and iron age do not make much difference for you, because you cannot properly visualize, then your efforts will be slow. If on the other hand you say, oh, there is a lot of change, enormous difference between golden age and iron age, between the human beings, between the animals and birds, between the flora and fauna, between the land, between the scenic beauty, between the purity of elements, between the relations between human beings, so on and so forth. The social, the economic, the political, and the cultural, educational, administrative, all kinds of setup you can visualize, can make, your mind can make a complete picture, and very clear picture. Then you will see this world is hell, that world is heaven. If your visualization does not give you this kind of experience, as the difference between the inferno, the hell, and the heaven, the paradise, which is the aspiration of all human souls, for which we all make these efforts, for which we use all our energy, our efforts will not be full-fledged. They would not be rapid progress giving. So this power of visualization we have to build up by practice. Because it may happen in some cases that due to our past sanskaras, due to lack of practice of visualization, this power, this ability may have atrophied. When we do not use one or two or three or some of our abilities, they die out after some time. Each one of us may know how to sing, but since we have never been singing, not been using this ability, we have not built up. So therefore, we feel shy, we feel hesitant, we say, I cannot sing. But who told you that you cannot sing? You did not practice. You can, but you did not practice. You did not use this ability. So therefore, this ability may have dried out. If you now try to develop this faculty, this ability, it may, to an extent, maybe not fully, but to an extent, it may get developed again. Therefore, they say there are two kinds of things. One is nature, the other is nurture. Sometimes we say our nature is like this. But certain things can be changed by nurture. So if I nurture this ability of singing, just go into the bathroom and sing for a while when no one is listening, you know, and try to see how the other person was singing and try to follow, and maybe that a day will come when people say, oh, you sing very melodiously, very well. Will you give us a song this evening on the stage? Possible. So this power of visualization is there in all the souls. And if we cannot visualize Shiv Baba in our mind, we are spiritually blind. Spiritually blind. Some people say we cannot practice meditation. Our mind does not stay. There is no concentration. We cannot hold our mind. Maybe there can be other factors, but maybe that this is due to our spiritual blindness, our mental blindness. Our thoughts cannot reach it, cannot picture it. The camera of our mind is perhaps not that fully developed camera, good camera with good lens. The lens perhaps is not that polished, that proper one. Or that mirror which can take that reflection is not so powerful. Our eyes cannot telescope to that distant object or subject, and we cannot experience it. Some people have clear audience, clear vision, so on and so forth. But they do not speak of this kind of vision, which the seers, that is why they are called seers. See, there are two types of spiritual persons, seers and sages. Sages have that wisdom, divine intellect. They have the sagacity. The other are the seers. They can see. To see an infinitesimal thing, which even the mathematicians cannot quantify, infinitesimal point of light, to see it, how powerful should be the vision? You can see grass things, bulky things, things of big size. Some people can see things of minute size. But how minute can you see? We have a range of vision. Anything which falls within that range you can see. But nobody can see infinitesimal. They have developed powerful electronic microscopes, but not any microscope which can take anything beyond the minutest virus. This one is without a body. It is not even molecular, not atomic, not even subatomic. It is much, much smaller, the subtlest that can possibly be. Nothing can be beyond it, smaller than that. To visualize that, we must require a very good ability, where our mind is not blurred. It is not disturbed by the storms, by the winds, by the clouds, by the dust. Like sometimes our vision is. We have a vision, but there is a fog. We cannot see another vehicle coming from the opposite side. There is a dust storm, and we cannot see beyond that tree. There is a wall, and we cannot see beyond that. Similarly, hatred, jealousy, rivalry, anger, greed, they blur our vision. We don't have purity. Our real nature has got that powerful vision. Else, why should we not be able to see our Father? Why should the soul Who has the right?
In India, all systems of philosophy are called the darshanas. Darshan. Darshan means philosophy. Darshan also means to see, to have the vision. Philosophy should give you a vision so that you should be able to see. Whenever some people talk to others, after every 2-3 sentences, they say, "You see what I mean? You see what I mean?" Now, what you mean is not to be seen, perhaps, to be understood. But for him, seeing is understanding. Understanding is seeing. Because seeing makes things clear. It gives you a clear picture. So you may be understanding the meaning, but are you seeing what I mean to say? Because it is not only to be understood, but you have to see it from the inside. Perhaps you may be seeing it from the outside, but it is not only to be the outer side, the outlook, as people say, outlook. But it has also to be the inlook, the insight, the divine sight, the hindsight, the front sight. Because you must know the past, that is the hindsight. You must know the future, that is the foresight. And you must know the inner, that is the insight. So seeing that vision, knowledge should open our eyes. Our eyes were closed. Baba said, still your eyes are not yet open. When a person wakes but is still feeling like sleeping, some people, when they have enjoyed the sleep, had full rest, their eyes are wide open. Others who just want to sleep, their eyes are only half open, partially open, because the brain centers are still sleeping. Though that alarm has woken that person up, but mentally he is sleeping. So, are our eyes open? Can we see? Can we see the mind of others? Can we see the thoughts of others? We have not yet developed that ability, which abilities are natural to all of us. It is because our mind is not innocent. It is not pure. It is buried under the debris of our so many previous negative thoughts. The old civilizations have vanished, but buried under the lot of debris. So when these people excavate, then something comes up. Some treasures, some cities, and then the historians try to see what kind of civilization of Egypt, of Greece, of other places it was. Because our eyes can't go just under the debris and see that a civilization is buried. But when the debris is removed, then we see. Our mind is now not developed. It is because it is under debris of hatred, of jealousy, of anger, of greed, of attachment. All the time we see the body, our outward vision. We do not have that inward vision. That faculty is not developed. Because the way we were brought up from our childhood, the way our schooling was, the way our culture, our cultural upbringing was, the society as it is today, no one at no point developed our inner faculty, so our knowledge was not, our philosophy was not that darshan, that seeing, yes I see. Do you see? He said, yes I see. So that power of vision has to be developed. Otherwise there will be that blindness, that effort cannot be made. A blind man cannot walk quickly. The effort on our part, our spiritual effort, cannot therefore be rapid. We have to just take a stick in our hand and with the help of it, just walk little by little. And then is the power, the fourth power, the power to evaluate. The power to evaluate and to judge. Fourth power, the power to evaluate the difference and to judge. Now, when Baba saw this coming destruction of the Iron Age world, and he also had a vision of the Golden Age, and some supreme power who said, I am Shiva, Shivoham, Shivoham, he entered into his body. He said, you have to create the new world. He told Brahma Baba at that time that I am light, I am might, I am Shiv Baba, and I have come to tell you that a new world order is coming and you have to become instrument for creating it. So Baba used to say, but he did not tell me how to create that world. He stopped at that, saying that a new world is to be created. He gave me this, he assigned this role to me. But how I have to play that role, at that point he went away, leaving my body there. So he was in a contemplative mood to see as to what he has to create, how he has to create. He said, I did not know. He only just gave me the commandment, you have to do that. But when he saw those visions of destruction and of golden age, so much was the difference to him, the wide difference, very, very wide difference, that he wound up his business. He gave up everything and he said, all of you come with me. We go to a new world order. We have to create a new world order. If you are my sons, my wife, my children, if you believe me, come with me. Give up everything. A new world order has to be created. It is the order of the highest. Because he understood the difference, he evaluated. He could evaluate the Kali Yuga as distinguished from Satyuga in a very powerful, very clear way. Therefore, he could make this judgment with no time. He did not take so many years to arrive at the conclusion what he is going to do, whether he is going to continue with his business at Calcutta and Karachi, or he is going to stop his account books, close his account books, and finalize everything, and just open a new chapter, altogether a new chapter of life. Everyone is my child, my previous relationships are finished. I now die from the old and take a new birth. So much did he do, because he could judge. And how he could judge? Because he could understand the difference. So, he could evaluate. What does a judge do? The official job of a judge is to listen to both sides of the party and to consider the merits and demerits, to evaluate them, to understand the difference. And when you understand the difference, you understand what is right as distinguished from right, what is correct, what is falsehood. You evaluate the evidence placed in favor of both the cases before you, and you finally deliver the judgment. That is what a judge does. So if we want to develop the power of judgment, how can we do without developing our power of evaluation? How can we become good judge of our own selves? Baba said, become your own judge the other day in Murli. We can become our own judge if we understand the difference between the body conscious life and the soul conscious life, between the vicious life and the pure life, between the life in Kali Yuga and life in Satyuga, between this kind of knowledge and that kind of knowledge, between this kind of relationship and that kind of relationship. All this knowledge is giving you a difference between this and that, right and wrong. On one side is the view God is omnipresent. On the other side is the view God is a point of light. Now what is the difference? How much difference it makes in your life? One gives you purity, gives you concentration, establish your link, your communication with Shiv Baba. The other gives you a wrong knowledge and therefore you judge and then you say Shiv Baba is my father. It's not that I am God. Not Aham Brahmasmi as was being said in today's Murli. That I am God. I am a child of God. It makes a lot of difference. Either you think I am God or I am a child of God. If you are God, you should be almighty, you should be all knowledgeful, all powerful, all peaceful. You are not. So this is falsehood and that is knowledge. And this is as the difference between the chalk and the cheese. Both are white. What would you eat? The chalk or the cheese? If you eat the chalk, you die. If you eat the cheese, you get so much calcium. So there is a lot of difference. Of course, the chalk also has calcium, but it is not digestible and eatable. It's not an article of food. So what I want to say is to understand the difference. You understand knowledge, but you cannot understand knowledge properly unless you understand the difference There are various views, various systems of philosophy, various theologies, various spiritual discourses. But you must understand the difference and evaluate, and then only you can put into practice and judge. So, one of the reasons why we are not making spiritual progress is we don't make judgment. Like our government, people give them some application for something. Then they send them reminders. Then a second reminder, a third reminder, a fourth reminder. And the file goes on becoming bulky with all those reminders and subsequent reminders. You send them fax messages, telegrams, urgent, marked urgent, so on. All go to the file. That bureaucracy works on it. Because it must work, otherwise it cannot live. So it does. But you do not get what you want. Why? Because the bureaucracy does not make the judgment. See? Many of us suffer because they do not make judgment. There are thousands of cases in our, perhaps lakhs of cases in our Supreme Courts and High Courts, pending cases. They are yet in the file. The judgments have yet to be delivered. Parties to the suit have to be called to the court. They are there. Judgment is not made. If a patient is taken to a doctor and it is in a serious condition and the doctor is not able to diagnose and judge what treatment the patient needs, the patient may die by that time. Before you have thought of what you are going to do, what medicine you are going to prescribe, the patient may die. They say time and tide wait for none. So if we do not make judgments, do not understand the difference, do not evaluate the impact, and therefore postpone our final decisions. Some people dedicate after so many years, some others after so many years, some still wait when they will dedicate. You see, certain things have to be done then and there. Shubham to Shigram. They say the best thing must be done instantly, I was saying the other day. Bad things should be postponed. But good things must be done immediately. So if the decisions are not made because the evaluation is delayed, then we cannot make a rapid progress. Baba said, if someone goes to an insurance company, a life insurance company, and says, I want to insure myself, fills up all the forms necessary to be filled up, has a medical checkup which is necessary under the law, before your policy is accepted, and everything is fine, decided, your photograph is there, your details are given, and everything has been verified, confirmed, but you have to make your first payment, that's all. Before you have made it, the policy does not work. It is only on paper, it has not yet started. If before that you die, that policy is not insurance, you won't get anything, not a single rupee. But if you have made your first payment, you get the full amount. You might have been insured for 20 years, but you die after 20 days. You will be getting the full benefit of your insurance policy. Pardon? Yeah, because the others who get it on my behalf, they will offer bhog to me, I get at least that much benefit. Or, if I have made a will that my insurance money should be used for building a center after me, then if a center is opened, I may get my commission. Shri Baba would give me, wherever I am. So these things have also to be understood, how I can get my insurance after my death. People know that others would get it before me. There are other ways of doing it. Am I right? Okay. But I am not insured. Because after the class, somebody may come and say, Jagdish bhai, what you will do with your insurance money? So, I am insured only with Shiv Baba. So, to make the decision, to evaluate, to understand the difference, this is one of the powers which we have to build up. And the other is power of will. Will power. The ability to will and the will power. If this power is weak, our efforts would also be weak. The moment you decide to do something, problems begin to crop up. Let us understand, when a person begins to run, the resistance of the wind starts. The friction of your feet with the earth starts. When the train begins to move, the wind from the opposite side strikes the engine and the vehicle, the compartments with as much force as the speed of the train. This is the law, because as the action, so the reaction depend upon each other. So when you make the decision, you are going to become pure, you are going to spiritualize yourself, you are going to be a yogi, problems begin to come. Maybe from your mind, maybe from your relatives, maybe from your colleagues, from your other things. Resistance is natural. That resistance has to be won. Resistance is a part of the story. It is inbuilt. There are certain inbuilt things in the mechanism itself, which you can't avoid. Old sanskaras also, that is one of the factors. That is resistance from our within. Maybe our sanskaras in various forms come up. So these things will be there. If your willpower is not strong, you will give up your efforts. You will go back to where from you started. Back to square number one. So this will, or if you just continue with it, as was the song this morning, Raat ke rahi thak mat jana, subho ki manzil dur nahi. O travelers of the night, don't feel fatigued, don't get tired. Because what makes us fatigued is the resistance which we have to face. That will be there. And for that you have to protect yourself, you have to prepare yourself, you have to have that kind of a device. Like you have a silencer for certain things, like you have adopted some anti-pollution measures for certain reasons. Certain measures are adopted for certain things. But let us understand that it is inbuilt. Therefore, we have to have the courage, else everybody would become a yogi. No. But once when you decide to become a yogi, there will be temptations. Very big. When one decides to become an honest person, I will have integrity, I will be an honest person, I will earn by my effort, I will not take any bribe. Now, when one makes this firm decision, then the very next day somebody comes and wants to make a payment under the table, saying, I give you $1 million if you do this for me. $1 million, my lord. So I take this, and then from day after next, I become honest. You see. So that willpower being strong, he says, up to today I have been not been honest. So how much difference does it make if for another 2 days I am not honest? All right, I become honest, I have decided, but not today. Not on Friday, maybe from Sunday, you see. So that kind of thing. Why people can't give up smoking, drinking, or other kinds of habits? Because of weak will. They decide. They also make the value judgments. They also evaluate. They understand the difference. But then they have no will. Will power. So this power has to be built up. Without that there cannot be spiritual, great spiritual efforts. We cannot become Mahan, the great souls. The greatness of great people lies in the fact that there was so much resistance. So many people raise their fingers, they accuse them, they blame them. They put obstacles in their way. They became problems. And yet, that could not defray them from their path which they had taken. They did not deviate. They set their eyes on the target. They marched towards their goal steadfastly. If you want to be steadfast in your efforts, willpower is a must. You must take this tonic. This is the tonic. You must have. Without that, there will not be progress. So this is another ability or power which by practice, with our attention on it, we have to build up in order to make strong. You know, even in the earlier days, when the institution was founded, we find there was so much social resistance from various groups, various communities, various kinds of people. But Baba could, at that time, when others had not accepted this knowledge, or very few had accepted this knowledge, and they had no social, political or economic position, with those few, he could just march forward towards the goal and build up this great institution. It was because he had meticulous, very strong willpower. That is what enabled him to march steadfastly onwards, onwards and onwards. Another is the sixth one, the power of self-confidence. If you think that yoga is not for me or I am not for yoga, as Baba was saying, is it that some of you think that you can't do it? In various ways he asked last night from time to time, whether you think it's difficult, that you can't do it. Now, if we have that self-confidence, half the battle is over. That in itself gives a strong willpower. Willpower and strong will go together. Self-confidence. So let us have self-confidence. And one of the ways of having self-confidence is that we are under the umbrella of Baba. He is our companion. He will help us. He has been saying times out of number, Himmat bache madad baap. If you just march one step towards me, I march 100 steps towards you. Children, I am going to help you. But the only thing is you must take the initiative. After all, if you want to learn swimming, if you don't want to go into the water, how someone can teach you swimming? You must first of all be thrown on the water and try to save yourself. And then your teacher or your master comes and tells you how to save yourself from drowning or how to know swimming. Similarly, you have to make the efforts. You start with it. And Baba says, I am your protector, your helper, your guide. And these problems will come because you have to become Vighna Vinashak, the troubleshooters. You will be able to, if you want to learn wrestling or boxing, you have to fight. You have to play that wrestling match against another heavyweight or lightweight who matches you. Else how can you learn it? How can you practice it? So these problems will come because they are a part of your training. They are meant for this. The tests are there in a teaching system. They are a standard of measurement. Without that you cannot know whether you have understood something or not. They have to be there, the tests. But if you have self-confidence, then you can pass those tests. Why? Because if you lose your self-confidence, then one of the consequences is you become nervous. Your abilities fritter away. You have no grip over your abilities. You can't hold them together to fight the problem which faces you. It is because you are scared. And they say the weak people die many times before death. Before the actual death comes. They have already died many number of times. Someone jumps out of deep scare even when one sees a small rat in the room. Many of our sisters. Maybe some brothers, you see. When they see a cockroach, you know. They say, cockroach, you know. So, even one may be afraid of a dark shadow, thinking that it is a ghost, would catch me by my throat. There is a small sound and somebody thinks a ghost has entered my room and is going upstairs. Maybe it will come, one rushes to the door to close it without knowing that the ghost can cross the door. There is no use of closing the door. Only you must not feel scared. Then the other one will feel you scared. If a person is scared of the cat and the cat is scared of the person, you know, both are scared of each other and therefore both are in ready for fight. Because See, actually both must be relaxed. There will be no fight. But since it is a cat, it is a human being just going to attack me. So both want to attack each other. The vibrations, you know, those vibrations, as Baba says, vritti se vatavaran banta hai. Your mind creates that atmosphere. Because you lose that confidence. Otherwise, if you have that self-confidence, you will be able to score a full victory. So this power of self-confidence, I have to become great, a great yogi. Just see your image. Have that vision. You are sitting on a lotus of light in your samadhi. Your mind totally absorbed into Shiv Baba's remembrance. Light surrounding you on all sides. You are emitting deep vibrations, powerful rays of light and might. All over the globe they are spreading. Even the elements are getting transformed. And you are in such an ecstasy, such a high spiritual state, that is what you are. Baba says, as the aim, as your goal, so is your life. Jaisa laksh, vaisa lakshan. Why should there be difference between laksh and lakshan, as he was saying? Your vision and your life, your signs. There is a lot of difference nowadays, he says. That must be bridged. That gulf must be breached. So have that image. I will become. If you think, I don't know whether I become or not become, then you do not become a philosopher, but a doubting philosopher. If you become a doubting philosopher or a shouting philosopher, what kind of philosopher you become, it is up to you. Some people shout at others saying that you are going all right, but this man disturbed you. Otherwise you were in peaceful state. This man disturb your peace. So you are a shouting philosopher. But if you say that you do not know whether you would be able to attain complete purity or you won't be, then you are a doubting philosopher. So it all depends upon you, what kind of vision you have. That I am completely pure, that is my original nature. Baba selected me out of millions. He knows my future. He knows my role. As why he brought me here. He knows the present, the past and the future. He knows my past, my present and my future. Therefore he says, you are my chosen few. I love you so much, he was saying last night also. I love you so much. How much is so much, I do not know. But so much, he said, I love you so much. This much, this much, this much. How much is so much? But he loves us very deeply, very profoundly. He says, I love you. His words are true. Take him at his words. He is the most trustworthy person. Any person can betray you. But he is the one, if you take him on faith, on his words, you stick to it, he will never leave you. He says, I love you. I say, I love you so much, if you love me. And you just have faith in him, he says, I will help you. Don't think, I don't know whether he will help me or not. He will help you. Have that kind of confidence. So then you are going to win. He says, you are my victorious children, my Vijay Ratna, Vijay Vats. I have written victory, the sign of victory is there on your forehead. My dear children, my sweet children, the moment you took this birth, I gave you a tilak mark, a sacred mark, the sign of victory. I see a crown on your face. You are all my sons, you are Raja Yogi, the kings, the queens. So do you think that he is just befooling us? He is telling a lie? God, whom people say is the truth personified. In this whole assembly, at a sacred place, face to face, that Dharamraj, he is telling us, if you don't take him at his words, whom you are going to believe then? If you don't believe him, you cannot have self-confidence. So there may be a weakness in you. If you know your weakness, okay, you know it, that there is there in you. But he is going to fill up. He is almighty. I may not have confidence in myself because I know I am a weak person. But the other one who is going to help me, who has promised me, India may be a weak country. But when India and Pakistan entered into war, and India had an assurance from USSR, then they thought that if USA helps Pakistan, then Russia is on our side, USSR is on our side, and USSR is also a nuclear power. And they can both confront each other America will think twice before it helps Pakistan. So therefore, they had some guts, some confidence. Yes, we can enter into this war. So I may have my problems. I may be having many kinds of shortcomings. But here is one who is full. Knowledge full, peace full, bliss full, love full. All full. I may be empty, totally. He is full. And he is saying that he assures me, my beloved children, I love you. My whole property is your inheritance. I have come to give it to you. I will take you across. I assure you. Rest upon my words. My sweet children, I take you on my eyelashes, on the shoulders, into my lap. I will certainly take you across. Then, if we don't have self-confidence, who can save us? If I want to die, to commit suicide, maybe if someone can save me today from putting kerosene on me and lighting a matchstick, then tomorrow I may do it. A day after tomorrow I may do it. Who will follow me everywhere I go? I may go in bathroom and there I may commit the suicide. So having lack of self-confidence is like committing your suicide. It is a spiritual suicide. Suicidal act. He is giving you a new lease, a new life. A golden life after life. A sustenance. A resuscitation, a renewal, a reinvigoration, a recapacitization, and we are not accepting. We say, no, no, I know myself. I know, if I knew myself, then I did not know that I do not know. I did not even know this, that I do not know. It is only he told me that I am soul that I came to know. So if then also I say I know, I am trying to make sure of my ignorance, as a matter of fact, because I knew nothing, absolutely nothing, not only zero, but minus something, because if I had not learned anything, it would have been better. I had learned the wrong things. Someone said, my daughter already knows some dancing, she has learned it from such and such, can you give her some more coaching to make her more proficient in this art of dancing? He said, it's very difficult. He said, why? But he has learned already some part of it. What he meant was that she has wrongly learned it. Now in order to give her a proper training, she has to unlearn which she has learned for years. She has made difficult for me to give her the art of dancing. It would have been better if she had not learned it. So not only, now also when they address persons who are considered to be very brilliant in academic fields, they say he is a man of great learning. Instead of it, the actual fact is he is a man who has wrongly unlearned, you see, wrongly learned, and now he has to unlearn. Much of Baba's effort on us is because of our wrong learning that is taking time.